We are recording. I believe we ended with the, well, I think we ended with a couple of battles, but a reminder about the strategies. The Union had their Anaconda plan to basically squeeze the Confederates and divide them, much as an anaconda will wrap itself around its prey and squeeze it to death. The United States Navy would blockade the coasts and the ports. The land troops would come down the rivers, the inland waterways, and try to divide the Union or the Confederacy. And then the main Union Army would stay around Washington, D.C. to protect the Capitol, but also try to capture Richmond, just about 100 miles to the south, the Confederate capital. The Confederates would wage a defensive war and try to wear down the North in hopes that eventually England or France would join in and help them fight against the Union, especially since they were supplied with cotton from the South. We talked about some battles that led up to July of 1862. These are a list of the 10 bloodiest battles in the Civil War. I did not start with these, but we did we're picking up today with the Second Bull Run. We talked about the First Bull Run, and it was just a battle that was just a few hours. It was a Confederate victory, and that's where we first were introduced to Stonewall Jackson. The Battle of New Orleans was a Union victory that gave them control of the largest Confederate city. And then I mentioned briefly the 7 days battle that was a Confederate victory. The second battle at Bull Run in Northern Virginia was again another victory for the Confederates. And in this battle, you had both General Lee and Stonewall Jackson. Winning a battle against a larger Union army and driving them back to the North. So as you can see, the Confederates have experienced more victories in the first year and a half of the war. And while they are not they're not advancing northward and gaining territory, they are holding off the larger Union armies. Except for losing New Orleans, they have been able to keep the Union troops, the ground troops, from advancing south and basically gaining strongholds. During this time, the morale of the Union, the North, their morale has been eroding because they continue to suffer these losses. And when morale starts to erode, there is also in the government leaders who are starting to doubt and question President Lincoln's leadership. Remember, there was also, let me go back up to this map for you very quickly. There were also these border states who had remained neutral and if the Confederates are continuing to experience victories, the thinking in the North is that these border states will see the way that the tide of the war, the way that it's going, that it's going towards the South, and they will be more inclined to join the South and therefore give the South more troops. Because right now, the Union has more troops. So President Lincoln does something to try to boost Northern morale and help the war effort. So, one of the things that the North did was any slaves who had escaped from the South during the war, they escaped to Northern troops and sought protection and freedom, would be known as contrabands. And they not only would reside with the Union troops, but also they would reside with Union troops who had gained control of Confederate territory. And many of these escaped slaves would be put to work by Union officers, building fortifications, tending to the livestock, digging trenches, burying the dead. This is important in 1862 because we're going to start seeing small steps towards emancipation of the slaves. Also early in 1862, President Lincoln signed some legislation that would have an effect on this emancipation mindset. In April of 1862, he abolished slavery in the District of Columbia. So up here where DC is, wrong way, sorry. Slavery is now abolished in the District of Columbia, this little chunk right here. And then on June 19th, 2 months later, another act was signed that excluded slavery from all the Western territory. So that would wipe out, anyone want to guess? One of the things that some of the senators tried to introduce to stay neutral. Yeah, popular sovereignty. Another thing that is happening in 1862 with President Lincoln is the his mindset about the war is starting to change. Remember, his main objective at the beginning of the war was to simply restore the Union. It was not about freeing all slaves. It was simply about restoring all the states to the Union. Slavery would no longer be able to expand into new territories, but the South would continue to be able to keep their laws about slavery and maintain slaves. Well, in 1862, Lincoln's thinking on the war is starting to change. He is starting to swing more towards emancipation of all slaves and abolishing slavery completely. So that's 1862, and actually the second Bull Run came after those things that Lincoln signed into law. The turning point of the war, according to many Civil War scholars, is the battle at Antietam in September of 1862. General Lee, the leader of the Confederate forces, is going to go against conventional military strategy, and he is going to make a bold move in hopes of bringing the war to an end. And so during this battle, Lee moves from a defensive posture to a very aggressive strategy. And he moves his 40,000 troops to cross the Potomac River into western Maryland. So here is Washington, D.C. on the Potomac River here. Maryland is on this side. Virginia is over here. Lee leads his troops northward with the goal of objectives. The ultimate goal was to win the war, to bring it to an end. But his objective here was to push the Union troops back away from D.C. area, and also to relieve pressure on Richmond, the Confederate capital. So a very bold move for General Lee with an army that is about half the size of the Union army. Now, you might call it, now Christians of that time in the North would have called it divine providence. People who just wanted to see the Union saved and restored and slavery outlawed might have said it was destiny, it was fate. However you label it, in one of the most amazing coincidences of the war, and this is such a small thing, but it has such a huge effect, is that General Lee's detailed battle plans for this battle were wrapped around three cigars. And the soldier who carried those cigars apparently dropped them. And the Union Army was able to find them and have access to these detailed plans. So they were able to, under General McClellan, the Union soldiers, 100,000 soldiers were able to quickly move in and scatter and stop Lee's army and push them back and put them on the run. And so during one night, the Union army continually shelled the, bombed and shelled the Confederate forces throughout the next day also. And then the next evening, under fog and drizzly weather, Lee led his troops back across the Potomac River. They were able to get back into Virginia. And technically, the Battle of Antietam was a draw because McClellan did not move in for the kill and capture the army and bring the war to an end. So technically it was a draw, but it really was a turning point for the war. Abraham Lincoln was not happy with his general McClellan. McClellan continued to show himself to be a hesitant leader. He worried about losing, and so he was very timid, and eventually Lincoln replaced him. But after this pushback of the Confederates, just 5 days later, President Lincoln also made a bold move like General Lee. And he, he issued the Emancipation Proclamation, September 22nd, 1862. And actually, this was just the first part of that emancipation. What it said was that it was a warning from President Lincoln to the Confederacy that if they did not stop fighting immediately, all the slaves in the rebel states would be made free forever in exactly 100 days, which would be January 1st, 1863. So this was exactly what the title says. It was really just a proclamation. But this is what Lincoln was hoping would happen. Because, again, even though they had pushed back the army, the Confederate army at Antietam, there was still low morale in the North. There were still there was still pressure in the government for the war to end quickly, for there to be a quick peace. And so President Lincoln was hoping that this proclamation would mainly embolden the slaves in the rebel states, that they would be emboldened to escape from their slave owners and come to the North and find emancipation. Because remember, before this time, the objective of the war was simply to restore the Union. It would not do away with slavery in the South. So Lincoln is hoping that this will motivate slaves in the South to run away, come to the Union, and not only get their freedom, but also fight with the Union against their former slaves. Now, the only people in the North who liked this were the abolitionists. There were still many people in the North who were like Lincoln, who just simply wanted to restore the Union. They did not want an influx of former slaves coming into the North. There was still a prejudice against African Americans that was not just, you know, they didn't think that they should be enslaved, but there was a prejudice that they were an inferior race. And then you had all the industrial workers in the North who they did not want all these free slaves coming into the North and taking away their jobs. So Lincoln really was the proverbial between a rock and a hard place. But he did follow through on this Emancipation Proclamation. He still issued it. His convictions were changing, and he held to those convictions. So, in reality, this proclamation did not actually free all 500,000 slaves that were these are slaves in just the four border states, 500,000. It did not slave the 300,000 slaves that were in Tennessee, Western Virginia, or Coastal Carolina. They were not actually free, but they now had the president's word that if they are considered free, and so gave them great motivation to run away or rebel. It was also during this time that the purpose of the war shifted for President Lincoln. To where it was no longer just a conflict to restore the Union, but it was now a crusade to end slavery. And another result of this would be that Europe, especially Britain and France, would now give more legitimacy to the Union, because they had already outlawed slavery, and this would then almost make it virtually impossible for the Confederates to get the British and the French on their side. If they continued to hold on to slavery, they would lose all British and French support. The British were getting their cotton from somewhere else, so they really weren't hurting that bad. Any questions on these developments in 1862? You can see that Antietam and Second Bull Run were some of the deadliest battles, bloodiest battles, and I believe the Antietam battle, which was just one day, up to that point, and still to the end of the war, was the bloodiest single day in American history. All right, let's talk about one more battle that took place in 1862. and then we'll take our break. And that would be the Battle of Fredericksburg. And all these battles up here on this slide, the battles that I am highlighting are the ones found in your textbook. So some of these up here are not really highlighted in your textbook. So Fredericksburg, I'm going to have to go to another map to show you where that is. Here we go, south of Washington, D.C., kind of in the middle of the two capitals. At this battle, once again, you had a Confederate victory because of an inept Union general. President Lincoln had dismissed General McClellan. And incidentally, McClellan never led another troop again in the Civil War. And in 1864, while the war is still waging, there's still an election. And McClellan runs as a Democrat against Lincoln. That's a little interesting tidbit there. But President Lincoln had made, this is a great name too, General Ambrose Burnside as the new general of the Army of the Potomac. And this is a little interesting fact that you might have to use on Jeopardy someday. Are you guys keeping up with Jeopardy, by the way? The champion right now has won 20 straight games. That's the second most ever, and he's also the second most winningest in money. So he is pretty phenomenal. But anyway, today at 4:30, DVR Jeopardy if you can't watch it. But anyway, this General Ambrose Burnside had this thick woolly facial hair on the side of his face, which we get the word sideburns from. So sideburns were named for a guy named Burnside. Sideburns, Burnside. See that there? Isn't that neat? Almost as cool as the cigar plans of General Lee. But anyway, Burnside was not, he might have been a good soldier, but as a leader, he was a poor strategist. And he tried to raid some Confederate territory near Fredericksburg. And General Lee and his troops were good and entrenched on a hillside. And they drove the larger Union Army back one more time. This may have been General Lee's finest moment in the war. And once again, the morale in the North drops. Northern Democrats are winning more of the Senate seats in the North. So they're starting to erode the Republican majority. And Lincoln continues to opposition to Lincoln in both the North and the South continues to grow. And so by the end of 1862, Lincoln says, if there's any place worse than hell, I am in it. I mean, he was in a really difficult spot. So Fredericksburg, another Confederate victory. That brings us through the end of 1862. So let's take a break there. It's 10:16. Let's take a 5-minute break, which will be 10:21 when we come back. Does anybody have any questions during break?
They'll treat you too hungry and help you on the line. And if you come wrong, we'll see that you're bad. I wish I was worth them again. Now I conclude with a wish to go well.
Sweet, your dreams and your happiness well.
I'll be here for my journey again. I'm going to be with them again. I'm going to be with them again.
Was a secret chord that David played and pleased the Lord, but you don't really care for music, do ya? Well, it goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall in the major limb, a baffled king composing hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw within all the roof of beauty and the moonlight. Hallelujah. She tied you to her kitchen chair. She broke your throne and she cut your hair. And from your lips she drew the hallelujah. 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 Maybe there's a God of love, who's got to shoot somebody who's love. It's not the fight that you hear at night. It's not someone who can see the light. It's a broken, it's a broken heart. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah,
I thought you all would be curious to see what Mr. Burnside looked like if he really had the sideburns to merit getting the or if he had the facial hair to get his own name, sideburns. There you go.
That's crazy.
That's what you would think some kind of professional wrestler would have today. All right, we've got a few more battles to finish up, and we'll leave some time for some questions about the test. This next battle we want to talk about is in May of 1863. It's the Chancellorsville battle, where there was 30,000 casualties. The new Union general, Thomas Hooker, was an overconfident man. And once again, a larger Union army with, again, a not so much inept but just arrogant general was defeated by the smaller Confederate army led once again by General Lee and General Jackson, Chancellorsville. President Lincoln again makes a change, and this time he hit a home run. He picked a general who would bring a very aggressive style to the war. And he really had somewhat of a reckless had a reckless type of aggressiveness. And that was Ulysses S. Grant. And so in May of 1863, General Grant led a very aggressive campaign in Vicksburg, Mississippi, which is down here, you can see. Vicksburg was a city built on cliffs that overlooked the Mississippi River. And the strategy here was to gain control of Vicksburg, which was a key Confederate stronghold, a military fort there, gain control of it, and then gain control of the Mississippi River. Stop the imports of supplies and food and things like that to the Confederates, and also divide the more eastern portion of the lower South from Texas Louisiana, and Arkansas. And General Grant led the Union Army, his Union troops, to completely surround Vicksburg and make it impossible for any Confederate soldiers or civilians to escape. And so they were cut off completely from food and supplies, and the Union army continually bombarded them and shelled them with mortars. And this lasted for 47 days, from about May 19th to July 4th, 1863. Now, in June of 1863, June 30th, way up here in the north, in Pennsylvania, a little farming community called Gettysburg, General Lee of the Confederates, by this time, remember, Stonewall Jackson he died. So General Lee leads his troops to Gettysburg to engage the Union Army there, led by General Meade. And one of the main objectives was to alarm General Grant's army down here and get them to leave Vicksburg and come and help up here. Lee made another bold move. He led a grand charge that would turn out to be a grand failure. The Confederate troops were in a suicide charge against the entrenched Union troops. And this became the bloodiest, deadliest battle of the war, with 51,000 plus casualties. And it was just basically a 3 to 4 day campaign. But this was a Union victory. It ended on July 3rd. The very next day, July 4th, the Confederate general in Vicksburg finally surrendered to General Grant. So a key victories for the Union. And you have Confederate troops that are now tired. Many of them do not have shoes. They're hungry. They're just war weary. And so it is starting to turn towards the Union as far as the advantage and the momentum. So Gettysburg was July 3rd when it ended. You guys did an assignment concerning the Gettysburg Address, which was given on November 19th of 1863. It was a dedication of the Gettysburg battlefield as a national memorial. There's just a little tidbit about the Gettysburg Address, and some of you might know this. President Lincoln, was not the main speaker for that day. There was a professional orator, and I can't recall his name, who gave a speech before President Lincoln. And this man was well known in America. He gave a 2-hour speech before Lincoln stood up. 2 hours. And President Lincoln gets up, and you guys, as you read it, you saw how brief it is. I think 264 words or something like that. The guy who spoke before Lincoln said he was basically just blown away at how great Lincoln's speech was. And some great, great truths in the Gettysburg Address. And so that took place while the war was still waging. Also in November of 1863, you had another Union victory at Chattanooga. And so the Union victories are starting to really pile up. The next thing that I want to mention to you that is an event that is not a battle, but in March of 1864, Lincoln promotes Grant to lieutenant general and commander of the Union war effort. So Grant basically becomes Lee's counterpart in the North. Lee is the supreme commander in the South, and now Grant is made that in the North. And his aggressive style and leadership is now characterized by all the Northern armies. All right, let me go back up to this map. The battle at Petersburg, June of 1864 to April of 1865. That is a nine and a half month battle. This is a Union victory. This was a battle in which the Union troops were well supplied, and they wore the Confederate troops down, who became hungry and cold and tired. During this time, and it would have been in November of 1864, so right about the middle, President Lincoln wins re-election. He soundly defeats McClellan, the candidate from the South. And people in the North, and especially those in government, are starting to understand and believe in Lincoln's ability to lead and lead the Union through this war. The final thing that I want to mention as far as a battle, another general that was underneath Grant and Lincoln in the North was General William Tecumseh Sherman. And he too was cut from the cloth that Grant was. He was very aggressive. And from from November of 1864 to December of 1864, He marched all the way across Georgia here from Atlanta to Savannah on the coast. And this is what's known as Sherman's March to the Sea. And this was just a campaign of total war. And the Union Army under Sherman basically scorched the earth and destroyed all structures, railroads, supply depots, all these things, and just basically split the South right there, this lower South portion in half. And then in February of 1865, Sherman starts going north into South Carolina, where the secession had started, and then into North Carolina. Meanwhile, back up in Virginia, Grant is battling with Lee, and finally gets Lee and his soldiers at a place called Appomattox Courthouse. And for a little over a week, Grant and his troops wear down Lee and his troops. And on April 9th of 1865, General Lee surrenders to General Grant, bringing the war officially to an end. He signs a surrender proclamation. Now, not all of the Confederate troops, especially out in the West here, knew that. I believe the last Confederate general to surrender was Stand Watie, a Native American general in the Indian Territory. So that was a few months later, I think June of 1865. But the war comes to an end after 4 long years. Hundreds of thousands of deaths and casualties. Families had been divided, had fought against each other. Mothers and fathers lost all of their sons. It truly was a civil war in the most truest sense. And a few weeks later, a few months later, you have the 13th Amendment signed into law outlawing slavery in the United States of America. Within a week after Lee signs that surrender, President Lincoln will be assassinated. His plan for Reconstruction will not be put into place. President or Vice President Andrew Johnson becomes president, a Southern Democrat. His Reconstruction plan will not be put into place. But the plan of the Radical Republicans, I'm sorry, I got that mixed up. Johnson's plans will be put into place as opposed to the Radical Republicans of the North. So we'll stop there. And if you haven't taken American History 2, that's where you should pick up whenever you do take that. As far as the test is concerned, you'll want to know about the Emancipation Proclamation and that 1862 was a key year for the Civil War because Lincoln started to change his thinking about what the purpose of the war was for. And you'll want to know that the Emancipation Proclamation was a political strategy to help end the war by hopefully motivating Southern slaves to seek their freedom. Since we covered the Gettysburg Address in your assignment, you will not need to know that for the test. You'll need to know about these significant wars or these battles during the Civil War. Of course, know about Fort Sumter being the Confederate victory that brought the war to a beginning, started the war, April of 1861. Know about First Bull Run, July 21st, 1861, the first battle on land. Stonewall Jackson led the Confederates to victory. The Battle of New Orleans was a Union victory that gave them control of the largest Confederate city and an important port. Antietam was the turning point of the war. Know about Antietam. Know about Vicksburg and Gettysburg and Sherman's March to the Sea and Appomattox Courthouse. And I better mark these for myself. Do you have any questions? Oh, know about the significance of General Grant and his style of fighting. So you have any questions about any of the test material?
What day is the test?
So the test is 1 week from today, May 9th, same time. I will try to put all of this that I've told you is going to be on the test. I will have it. I will do it. Put it on one study guide. And we'll have that posted by Sunday. No class on Tuesday.
Will you tell us about Sherman's March one more time?
Sherman's March, sure. It was basically a total, it was a campaign of just total war from Atlanta, Georgia, down to Savannah, Georgia on the coast. And it was a war that it was a campaign that devastated the land physically. They burned. What?
From Atlanta to where?
Savannah.
Atlanta kind of in the south. Atlanta in the northwestern part of Georgia. And then diagonally southwest to Savannah on the coast, which would split that lower portion of the South in half. Also, the devastation of the land and all their structures would really hurt the economy and basically strike a blow to the Southerners' morale. And then after occupying Savannah for 2 months, they went north into South Carolina and North Carolina, continuing that total war campaign. And for Sherman, it was like he wanted to go to South Carolina and strike at the heart of the state that started the Civil War in his mind. They were the first state to secede. So by that time, you had the Union controlling Vicksburg and the Mississippi River. They controlled New Orleans and the port to the Mississippi. And now they have split, along with splitting Texas and Arkansas and Louisiana from the South, they've now split the remaining lower South in half. And that left it open for Grant to defeat Lee in the North. And so Lee is the now President Davis of the Confederacy would not surrender, and he escaped by steamboat from Richmond. But General Grant realized that they had lost, and he signed the surrender papers. So you can still text me or email me if you have any questions. Again, I'll have all of the things that I've told you on one study guide by Sunday. If for some reason you cannot take the test on Thursday, the official week for finals is actually the week after, but I wanted to plan it so you guys could get this out of the way and focus on other things. So if you cannot take it on Thursday, let me know and we'll set up another time. Otherwise, it's been a great semester. I've enjoyed it thoroughly. Hope it's been something that's benefited you. And good luck in your endeavors as you graduate and move on. Anything else? All right, we will.
You're fine this year.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
I miss you.
So we all think so in Muldrow. We think that you're the funniest.
Well, I'll take that with a, I might grow some sideburns because of that. You know, I don't know. Anyway, have a great day, great weekend, great graduation, great summer. And maybe we'll see you sometime in the future. Bye-bye.